Divine Truth Interviews. Jesus, Mary, and others are interviewed by members of the media and the public. Jesus is interviewed by Mary Magdalene on the topic of emotions. The interview was held on the 17th of April 2014 in Wilkesdale, Queensland, Australia. This is Session 1, Part 2.
This person asks, I often intellectually know what the underlying causal emotion or issue is, but I find it difficult to feel the emotion. How do I experience the deep emotion that needs to be accessed?
Well, firstly, this statement that you often intellectually know what the underlying causal emotion is, to me is also a bit of a intellectual tomfoolery that we play with ourselves. And most of the time you don't know, to be honest. And it's only when you actually feel an emotion that most of the time you know what its cause is. Mm. So any person who believes they intellectually know what their emotions are but they're not feeling them, it's highly unlikely they actually do intellectually know what their emotions are.
Yeah.
And it's even if they do intellectually know what their emotions are, that will not necessarily help you to feel it. So you might as well give up the whole process of trying to intellectually know anything and even stop telling yourself that you intellectually know things. You see, everything your mind processes comes from your soul anyway, and if your soul hasn't released a specific emotion yet, then you don't know it either at your soul level or intellectually.
Yeah.
So it's pointless telling yourself that you do. Oftentimes we want to tell ourselves that we do because we're addicted to the concept that we know. And in fact, we use knowledge as a way of allaying fear. Mm. So we try to tell ourselves, I don't have to be so afraid of that now that I know something about it. And that's where our problems all start. And in fact, the whole reason why we're not feeling underlying causal emotions is generally, as we've already explained in other FAQs on this emotional subject, and that is generally we are either in denial, we are in addiction, or we're terrified, we're afraid. It's usually one of those three reasons. Now, obviously, we need to go down through those particular processes. And if a person looks at, I think it was the previous FAQ I answered, FAQ in this session, yeah, they will have the answer of how to go down through all of those emotions.
Sure.
So I feel in this person's case, they need to firstly stop telling themselves that they intellectually know things. You don't know anything until you process through it emotionally. Until then, you're just regurgitating memories or you could say words that have been spoken to you. You don't really know much more than that at that point.
And it can even just be a theoretical idea, can't it? I think it's probably this because of these factors.
Yes.
But there's been no feeling involved in establishing that theory, really.
Of course. And also, the problem with trying to do this, the problem with intellectually knowing something, causes you to try to access an emotion that often is not present or often has layers of other emotions on top of it that you first need to feel.
Yeah.
And so, for example, a lot of people have a lot of rage which they don't wish to acknowledge. They feel embarrassed about acknowledging it, or they feel that they shouldn't have it, and they have lots of other judgments about the anger that they have within them. And so what they do is they tell themselves they don't have any anger. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And the same applies with many of their addictions. Like, most people have huge amounts of addictions in play in their day-to-day life, all suppressing certain fears and certain grief.
Yeah.
But what they tell themselves is they don't have those addictions. It's not an addiction that caused them to do this today or yesterday, or you know, caused them to eat this food or caused them to go and do this thing with another person. They tell themselves it was a pure desire. So they're always trying to feed intellectually. You're always trying to feed yourself validation of why your soul wishes to hang on to its suppression and its resistance.
Yeah.
So the problem with any intellectual processing, mm-hmm, if it's not, is that it's tainted with a lack of logic most of the time until you process through the emotion.
Yeah.
And while it's tainted with a lack of logic, you can guess that you have certain causal emotions, or you can assume that because certain events happen to you, you must have certain emotions. But that doesn't help you actually get into the emotions. What's going to help you is to be far more honest about the suppression and the resistance that you have, and then allow yourself to go through the rage first, the anger that you have, down into your, which comes from your addictions not getting met, down into the addictions, the expectations and demands that you have, that you would like to have met, and then through them into the actual fears that you actually have that are often suppress the grief. Mm-hmm. So what we need to do is go through that particular process. Now, the average person doesn't want to go through that process. They want to go, in most women's cases, they would like to go from where they are now right to the grief without and skip the fact that they're angry and skip the fact that they've got addictions, and definitely for most women skip the fact that they have no fear.
They think they want to have no fear.
Yeah. But they have lots of fear, lots of terror to feel, and most women don't want to feel that. Mm-hmm. In the case of men, oftentimes they will allow themselves to experience some anger because it's a bit more socially acceptable for a man to express anger. And so usually men are in less denial of their anger, but fear is a very weak place for most men to go to. They don't feel that they can go there. And for most men, sadness is the worst possible place for them to go. So, of course, they don't really want to go there.
Yeah.
So most men cycle between the stages of anger and addiction. Mm-hmm. And most women cycle between the stages of suppression of anger and addiction.
Yeah.
and unfortunately, that means that the majority of people do not know emotionally or intellectually what's really a causal emotion that they need to express in order to release themselves from their current condition.
Yeah.
And the only way you're going to know is by going down through that process. And most of us want to skip that process. And so most of us guess using our intellect, and our guesses are often very, very wrong. So we often receive emails, as you know, that where people say, oh, I feel it's about a low sense of worth, and we're going, no, it's not about a low sense of worth at all. In fact, you believe that you arrogantly think that you're better than other people, you know. So, you know, there's so many things that people say to us from an intellectual concept of what they think it is, and you can feel from them that it's totally different to what they're saying.
Even sometimes, if that might be the causal emotion that resides within them, there is still the issue that in avoidance of that, in their addiction, they behave very arrogantly.
Yes.
And if they try to skip to feeling the low sense of worth that may or may not be there, without first dealing with their
arrogance.
Unloving and addictive behaviour in arrogance, then it's not going to work, is it?
No. They've got to see things, you know, like, and you've got to go through the seeing of things in order for it to be a sincere process. You can't expect to just jump to an emotion that you would like it to be. And what we find is most people would like their emotions to be a certain way, and their true emotions are very, very different to what they would like their emotions to be. If you are truly honest with this process, you are most of the time going to be quite surprised when you get to the actual emotion, the actual causal emotion, as to what it really was or what it really is. And the reason why that is the case is because your soul, up until that time, is in suppression or denial, mm-hmm. or resistance to processing that particular emotion. And so everything coming into your mind, unless it's a thought dropped to you from your spirit friends or somebody else, someone outside of you, everything coming into your mind that's from your own thoughts and from your own feelings is going to be tainted with your resistance and suppression.
Yeah.
So it's going to be an excuse to suppress you from other things. And this is why most people who say that they know what their causal emotion is but they're not feeling it, they don't even know what their causal emotion is most of the time. Uh-huh. And this is the reason why they're not feeling it, because they don't know what it is. If they knew what it is and they were allowing the experience of it, they'd probably get there. Now, the second part of the question is, if you do actually know uh-huh. what your causal emotion is, which is possible, to intellectually sort of have a good idea of what it might be, and you're not experiencing the emotion, then obviously we need to look at the first three things: anger, addiction, and fear. It's got to be one of those three things blocking the flow of that emotion.
Mm-hmm.
And this is where most people really struggle. They don't want to acknowledge they're angry. They don't want to acknowledge they're afraid. And most of the time they like their addictions because their addictions give them everything they want, and they want to keep them.
Yeah.
And so for that reason, the majority of people, even if they do come to know intellectually what their causal emotion is, probably won't process it unless they go through the processing of the resistive emotions and the suppressive emotions, which are all related to anger, addictions and fear. Mm-hmm. And this is where we need to allow ourselves to go. And because anger, addictions and fear are generally unpleasant to acknowledge within us, a lot of them feel quite sleazy in terms of emotionally, so they feel quite shameful to experience. We often don't want to go there either, and this is why we become blocked.
Yeah.
My suggestion to a person in this kind of situation is to first stop trying to use their intellect to find what the emotion is, and instead use their intellect to find what the block is.
Yeah.
what's going on, what anger is in them, what addictions are in them, and what fears they have, and start to acknowledge those particular emotions. Because unless they acknowledge those emotions and go through the process of feeling those emotions and are ready to, mm-hmm. through the exercise of their will, desire to feel those emotions, they will never get to know what their causal emotions are.
So you're saying if we're not feeling our causal emotions, we could be guessing wrong.
Well, most likely we're guessing wrong, I'm saying. Yep. And if on the off chance that we're not, we're still not going through our fear, our anger, our addictions and our fear.
Because once we do that, our causal emotion will flow from us naturally.
Easily, like a child. Yep. Once you go through and release the blockages from you, the causal emotion just flows out of you, without any without any even need to access it intellectually. And a situation comes up, and because you're humble to your emotion now, and you're humble to what the experience is, and you don't worry so much about what everybody thinks of you, you just go straight into your emotion. You don't have to think about it, you don't have to worry about it, and you don't have to work it all out or any of those kind of things. And if you have to do all of those things, you are in a lot of fear.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, you are doing those things to avoid the feeling of your fears.
Mm-hmm.
And you are doing those things to avoid the work needed to be done in fear, addiction and anger, which are the main reasons why you block any emotion that's causal.
Mm. Great.
All right.
Can our darker emotions cause us to take actions that are not pure?
Always. Yes, always. Your darker emotions will cause you to take actions that are not pure all the time. So it's not a can, it's yes, it will always happen.
Mm-hmm.
The reason why is because the soul is dominant. This is the principle of dominance. So when we look at how the human soul functions, whatever is in the soul emotionally will dominate our everyday existence. So if we have darker emotions in our soul, and emotions where we'd like to harm people, or emotions of rage and anger, which that all comes from, or emotions of rebellion, which cause us to get into trouble a lot, or emotions driven by fears that we're trying to allay by using addictions, all of those types of emotions will definitely dominate.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, every single day, they will dominate you. So you can think you're suppressing them, but your actions and your words and your behaviour will be driven by them, and it will only be a supreme exercise of will that prevents you from acting them out.
Yeah.
And you won't be able to do it all the time. When you're put under strain or under pressure, you'll revert back to the dominance of the soul. So the soul and its emotions will dominate every single moment of your existence. So if your soul is full of dark emotions, they are going to dominate every day of your existence unless you exercise some supreme control of your will. And even then, given certain circumstances, you'll revert back to your old behaviour.
Uh-huh.
So you need to give up the concept that you can somehow bury your dark emotions and they have no effect on your life, because it's not true. They have an effect on your every single day-to-day life, every single moment of the day.
And isn't it true that the more we suppress our emotions, the more they dominate, our darker emotions, the more they dominate what we do?
Correct. This is why, a lot of religious faiths have this feeling of guilt. They teach you that you should do, these commandments, And every single person at some point can't do these commandments because of the dominance of their soul.
Yep.
And so they, you know, go ahead and they break one of the commandments. And then, of course, there's huge amounts of guilt associated with the breaking of one of the commandments. And so then you punish yourself for the breaking of a commandment. But that doesn't change anything either. So because your soul's dominant, you can punish yourself as much as you want, but you'll still go ahead and do it next time. And this is why, like a lot of religious faiths, for example, have this issue with masturbation, like particularly Christian religious faiths. And they're saying, you know, the man, or and usually it's referred to as the male that's got a problem with it, you know, needs to get it under control. This habitual masturbation is bad for him and all these kind of things, right? They don't have any real reason why this is the case, of course, but they do feel that it's somehow immoral. Mm-hmm. And so what they do is they feel you've got to get control of yourself, you know, you've got to control the fact that you want to do this. And the problem with that kind of reasoning is that it causes a person to believe that eventually they can control their soul with their mind.
Yeah.
And they can't.
Yeah.
And sooner or later they will relapse to their old behavior. And then, of course, because they're being told that it's all about control, they then feel guilty that they can't control. Mm-hmm. They would be far better off trying to find the causal emotional reason why they relapse into such behaviors. So habitual masturbation, for example, is driven by a large amount of sadness about intimacy. And sadness in the relationship with the opposite sex. So what the person would need to do is feel some of that sadness. Mm-hmm. When they feel some of that sadness, the feeling will dissipate and then they'll feel less drawn to habitual masturbation, and masturbation would just be more of a sexual enjoyment rather than something that's habitual, driven by a need or an addiction of some kind.
Yeah.
And so in this, and I'm not saying in this discussion, obviously, that masturbation is wrong, because the reality is if you're not allowed to touch yourself, then I would suggest nobody is.
And nobody else is able to touch you either.
Yeah, that's right. Why should somebody else be able to touch you when you can't? But the reality, though, is that there are many people who are addicted to it in order to avoid some of these emotions, and they would be far better off finding the emotion than they would trying to control the habit using their intellect.
Yeah.
You know, once you deal with the emotion and release it, you're not driven by the emotion anymore. And so now you have full control of your choices and decisions.
So if we use that example, you're speaking of a sadness about intimacy, for example, mm-hmm. can drive the habit of masturbation, habitual masturbation, if you like.
Yes. And well, can I make it even more plain? Even if the man is in a relationship, the majority of women do not give their hearts or give themselves sexually in a relationship. As a result, the man feels quite sad about this. So he's sad that he's not feeling the flow of sexual feelings from the woman to himself. As a result, he's going to be driven to masturbation if he does not feel the sadness that he feels about that. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Now, when he doesn't feel the sadness of that, he will feel like he has to masturbate in order to feel at least some kind of pleasure and somebody, sort of a feeling that something or somebody wants him type of feeling, even if it's he himself.
Yeah.
And this is what drives his habit.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in a relationship, if this man's in a relationship, there's quite a few things he needs to address. Firstly, he needs to address the woman's reluctance to share her heart or her sexual feelings with him. He also needs to address the fact that he needs that to survive. So he needs to feel about why he needs that to survive, what sadness within him causes him to need that to survive. And they are the causal emotions he actually needs to access. And so he might be afraid of addressing those things with the woman. He might be afraid of the woman and upsetting her and she goes completely and then he has no sex at all. He might be afraid of a number of different things that cause him to feel that masturbation is the way out of the situation, and rather than discussion with his girl, you know, in the case of what we're suggesting here with his partner, and he needs to work his way through those emotional issues. Now, it's the denial of those emotional issues that create the habit,
mm-hmm.
the addiction, and we need to understand that it's the denial of it. And it's not. Because somebody has lost control, they have no control because they are driven by their addiction.
Yeah.
Right. Pretty much all of our addictions are emotional, and then we have a few physical ones.
Yeah.
So you know, most people think it's the other way around, but it's not. It's that you have a few physical addictions, all driven by these large numbers of emotional addictions. Mm-hmm. That once you work your way through, you no longer have the physical addiction either. They automatically dissipate.
So clarifying what you're saying is that the question was, can our darker emotions cause us to take actions that are not pure? Mm-hmm. It sounds like it's the suppression of our darker emotions that actually drive us to take actions that are not pure. And
yes.
When we allow our darker emotions, we no longer feel driven to avoid them.
I suppose it depends on how you allow them. Like,
sure.
If you allow them from the point of view of experiencing them within yourself without taking them out on anyone else, mm-hmm. then yes, they haven't caused you to cause any problems for anybody else, and there will be a release inside of you. But the majority of people don't do that. What the majority of people do is they suppress them, or they allow them to actually have full reign over how they treat other people. Now, of course, that's going to even further darken the soul, and that is suppression and resistance to those dark emotions. Mm. So when I say dark emotions will always cause you to do dark things, that is always true, right, because of the dominance of the soul. You will always do dark things if you have dark emotions in them, inside of you. If you suppress them, you'll even do worse things.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Now, you have a choice. Do you suppress and resist, or do you feel them? Mm-hmm. Now, the majority of people choose to not feel them because they feel painful to feel, and what they choose to do is try to suppress them and resist them. In trying to suppress them and resist them, generally you will do even darker things.
Mm.
And this is how people who believe in love murder other people.
Yeah.
This is how, you know, women who believe in love, you know, kill an unborn child.
Yeah.
This is how, you know, it's all done through the darker emotions that exist within the soul, generating within the person thoughts that justify their behaviour.
Yeah.
So the darker emotions will always finish up doing that. They'll always generate thoughts that finish up justifying more unloving behaviour. Mm. And you can't avoid that because the soul is dominant.
Yeah.
What you can do is you can work on that happening. Why does it happen? You can get to the soul-based emotional reason why it's happening and release it, and then you can change.
Yeah.
But a force of will is not going to change you. You have to use extreme will, and even then put yourself in a difficult situation. You will do what the dark emotions dictate. So, for example, for a woman who normally believes that she loves children, she becomes pregnant from a one-night stand with a man that she hates, right, and that somehow she got into a sexual interaction with, and now she's pregnant. What does she do? Well, most of the time that woman wouldn't hesitate to take a morning after pill if it was available to her, or further than that, if she does become pregnant, abort the child.
Mm.
Now, in that way, the woman has become a murderess.
Mm.
But she's willing to justify the murderess by saying, oh, but I don't want the child, and it's not good to bring the child in the world. The child would be happier in the spirit, you know, in the afterlife. It would be happier without me, you know. Or they believe that the child hasn't even incarnated yet, you know. It's not a child yet until it's born. There's all sorts of justifications we make, all of which internally, most of the time, we know are false.
Yeah.
But we take them because the dark emotion generates those thoughts.
Mm-hmm.
So the dark emotion will always, always dominate in the end. And given the situation, it will always exert its power.
Mm.
And this is what we need to do, is we need to start looking at those dark emotions and let them go emotionally. We need to process them, experience them, feel them so that they release from us. Now there is no opportunity for them to control, because they're no longer in us.
Mm. Mm. It's funny, isn't it? Because almost everyone on the planet is trying to hide their darker emotions, a lot of times for fear of what they might do,
mm-hmm.
if they acknowledge those emotions.
Mm-hmm.
And yet from what you're saying, the more they're suppressed, the more dominant, more driven everyone is to keep them suppressed, and so they do justify more and more acts.
Yes,
that
and eventually
are
they do
impure.
Take actions, or they have to do the other thing, which is completely suppress every feeling in their soul, which is very damaging to yourself. So eventually they do one of those two things. If the dark emotion exists in the soul and you never release it, you carry it around like a burden, right? Sooner or later, in a situation that will come up and dominate, Or if you're very, very, very good at suppression, which most people on the earth are fairly good at because we've had lots of training. We had training from the moment we were conceived, right the way through our entire childhood, right the way into our adulthood. We've had training about how to suppress, and society is great at enforcing suppression. Because of that, we go, right, I'm going to suppress this. I'm going to suppress, like, I feel like cheating on my husband, but I'm going to suppress it. And then we come up with all these concepts and ideas. Doesn't matter where you get your sexual desires from, as long as you go home and you have sex with your husband, you know. Yeah. So it's okay if you watch a bit of porn, it's okay if you watch that guy walk down the street and all that kind of, as long as you go home and have sex with your husband, that's all fine, you know. And there's all these justifications, but see, this is the darkness of the soul dominating, and we then use our intellect to try, the soul uses its intellect to try and justify the soul's condition.
Yeah.
And this is always going to happen. And then what you do is you suppress that or attempt to. So you try hard, you know, you pray to God, you know, saying, help me overcome this evil desire and all these kind of things. And God's saying, well, the only way you're going to overcome this evil desire is to feel the evil desire and its cause. Yes. Why do you feel like doing that? And you'll trace that back to some childhood events and so forth. And once those things are released, you'll never feel like that again.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And it's fantastic knowing that. Because you can be confident about that anything that might be judged by yourself as evil inside of yourself can always be changed, as long as you find the causal emotion that causes it. And that's and this is the only action we can take with our so-called dark emotions. Yeah.
Great. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Why do we wish to ignore our darker emotions?
Because we believe that ignoring them will make them go away, which is, as we can see from our previous FAQ, that's not the case. Our dark emotions never go away if we ignore them. But there is this common viewpoint amongst humankind that if you ignore something, it will go away. And sometimes it does work with regard to people, you know. If you ignore them long enough, sometimes they do go away. But when it comes to our emotions, it never occurs that way. If we ignore them, they will continue to grow generally, and they will continue to manipulate and control our behavior. And so, you know, I feel the reality is ignoring dark emotions is a very dangerous thing to do. Mm-hmm. And in fact, it is the ignorance of dark emotions which causes us then to actually take dark actions. So if you are not ignorant of your dark emotions, in other words, if you can see them and you know what they are, then every time you feel one of them, you will go, oh, I've got to be careful now. Yeah. I've got to be careful what I'm going to do here now. Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
You have a tendency to be able to police yourself to a degree. But if you ignore your dark emotions, you won't even sometimes, and most of the time, be aware of them. And your thoughts will be more along the line of justifying their existence.
Yeah.
So you'll say to yourself things like, oh, I feel like killing that person, and no wonder, look at the person, you know. you won't even see that that's a dark emotion within yourself caused by something within yourself. You'll think it's caused by somebody outside of you. You'll think it's somebody else's fault that you feel this way.
Yeah.
And that's a very dangerous thing to do. Because when you start blaming other people or thinking it's someone else's fault that you feel certain things, you are not taking personal responsibility for your own emotions. And once that happens, you're in a very, you know, it's very short distance between that and actually taking action on your dark emotions. And it's very, very dangerous on a lot of levels, for your soul in particular.
Mm.
But also for the soul of others. Every single person that you damage with your, you know, acting out your dark emotions is another person that feels pain as a result of your actions, and they then have to go through their own experience of having to release their emotions about what you did.
Yeah.
And that just puts terrible burdens on other people.
Mm.
So not only are you harming yourself, but you're also harming all of the people that you've now interacted with using these dark emotions in your interactions.
Mm.
Yeah.
So you said at the beginning, we want to ignore the dark emotions because we're hoping they'll go away.
Mm.
And is that just because they feel unpleasant to feel, or is it because we have other issues of shame and judgment?
Oh, yeah, of course.
Why?
You know, we want them to go away for like 100 reasons. You know, some of them are that we feel that we're not a very good person if we have them, so we feel terrible feelings of guilt and shame about having these dark feelings and emotions inside of us. Or it could be just we're not that afraid of having the dark emotion inside of us. We're just concerned that other people might see it, you know, that other people might think that it's terrible. And we have all sorts of judgments, and we also take on society's judgments of some emotions. And so we also, you know, if they think this is bad, then we think it's bad. If they think it's good, we think it's good. Mm-hmm. And some of the things society thinks is good is actually dark emotions, unfortunately. And so we'll be often distorted in our reasoning when it comes to what is a dark emotion from God's perspective, and what is and what I'd classify as an evil emotion, if you like, from God's perspective, and what is a good or loving emotion from God's perspective. We often have huge distortions about that. So we have a lot of judgment about what is good and bad. So for example, a person who has homosexual feelings, who has been brought up in a Christian household, believes that their homosexual feelings are evil or bad or dark. Mm-hmm. But the reality is God created these kind of feelings. Mm-hmm. And so the reality is, from God's perspective, is they're okay. You know, there's nothing wrong with them. Yeah. But because the environment of the child is that they believed it was dark, now the child believes it's dark. So we have a lot of distortions about what is good, what is evil. Anything, obviously, from God's perspective that is unloving is usually driven by an evil or a dark emotion. Mm-hmm. And I'll use the term evil purposefully, because all evil that has ever been created, which is the damage of other people through the exercise of your will, has all been created because of some dark emotion that's been suppressed inside the individual and hasn't been allowed to be felt. Mm-hmm. So we're better off feeling them than we are acting upon them. Mm. And it's a very, very different state to feel them and act upon them.
So this habit that everyone is in, or this deep desire that everyone has to ignore these darker emotions that are inside of us, seem to be a huge stumbling block to society as a whole, and a kind of a global or societal issue that as children we're not taught to feel our dark emotions rather than...
Yes, we're taught to suppress them, we're taught to deny them, we're taught to judge them, we're taught to, you know, try to make them go away. There are some parents, of course, who do the opposite, who actually teach their children to act upon dark emotions because they themselves do that.
Yeah.
It just depends on our upbringing as to what we're taught. But the average person on the planet has some semblance of conscience, and so therefore some semblance of internal gauge as to what is good and what is not. Often it's heavily distorted, of course, but as a result, anything that the average person sees as not good, generally there's a lot of judgment on the planet about. Mm-hmm. So if the average person on Earth is challenged by homosexuality, they believe that homosexuality is bad. Does that make sense? Yeah. It's got nothing to do with what God thinks about the issue. It's got everything to do with what people generally in society feel about the issue. And this is the unfortunate thing. We judge a lot of what are good and decent emotions from God's perspective as bad. And then we judge a lot of what are quite evil emotions as good.
Yeah.
And then we judge a lot of stuff that is bad as really, really, really bad. And all of it we try to suppress. And so, of course, we're confused. Yeah. And, of course, we don't know what we're doing most of the time with the days, during the day. And, of course, we're going to act through the dominance of our soul that's being suppressed and resisted. And so this is why we end up taking a lot of very dark actions. And even as a society, we end up taking dark actions. You know, we're willing to go to war as an entire nation in order, which is an act of the entire nation, really, justified by a dark emotion. Mm. And these all of these justifications come from these dark emotions. And so it is imperative, if we ever want to become at one with God, and if we ever want to become loving, it's imperative to release these dark emotions from us so they no longer govern our life.
And the first step in doing that is presumably to stop ignoring that they're there.
Correct. You've got to stop denial, stop suppression, stop saying to yourself, I don't have any. Because if you didn't have any and everybody in the world didn't have any, then there wouldn't be any problems in the world.
Yeah.
We'd all be in loving interactions with each other and everyone would be happy. So the reality is we have them. And even in a standard relationship or a standard family, there's plenty of dark emotions. You know, you can just see them. So start dealing with them. Mm. Start acknowledging they're there. You know, I once said to somebody, all of our dark emotions are like, and I use the term shit in the middle of a room, and like a pile of it in the middle of the room, you know, a pile of poo in the middle of the room. It's all smelly. Everybody knows it's there and everyone walks around saying it's not there and that nothing smells. And unfortunately, that's how we treat our dark emotions most of the time. We're going around saying, it's not there. Nothing smells. When it stinks to high heaven and it's created like lots of problems in our lives. And it creates lots of problems still in our lives. And yet we're still going around saying, no, it's not there. It doesn't stink.
Yeah.
You know, and it's just crazy.
Yeah.
And it's amazing how, I sometimes feel it's just so amazing how like firm we are about our denial. Mm. Like things have to get pretty bad sometimes before we go, oh, maybe that's, that's the reason why, you know, that dark emotion might be the reason why I felt that way or, you know. And you often see violence in a household, whether it's towards children or between partners. You often see, you know, that's all driven by dark emotion. You often see people lying and stealing and cheating and all sorts. That's all driven by dark emotion. They're all emotions we can get rid of. They're all emotions that are not a part of our soul that we can let them go, but they're in our soul. And while they're in our soul, they will dictate through dominates. They will dictate the rest of our life until we release them.
Thank you. Okay, the next person's written us a little paragraph with a number of questions in it. So I'll read it all to you.
As we often have.
Yeah. And we can go back to different parts of it if you'd like.
Sure.
Okay. So they say, I understand that God's love is supposed to be able to enter us as we progress, but I suspect I'm a long way off from this. Mm-hmm. Does it really take a long time for some of us? And do we just need to be patient? Are there some signs that can show us that we're just not getting it? I feel like I'm just not getting some really basic stuff. I'm really struggling with allowing myself to feel these emotions in the first place and scared that they will never end. Where do I start?
Hmm. Yes, well, there's quite a lot of things in this question, isn't there? So let's have a look at some of them. If you read the first couple of sentences first, again, we'll just go through some of what's affecting this person. Again, I feel it's a lady, so we'll talk about what's affecting her.
So. Okay. I understand that God's love is supposed to be able to enter us as we progress, but I suspect I'm a long way off from this.
Let's just look at, it's interesting terminology sometimes, how the terminology people use and how it actually influences their emotions without them really understanding the influence.
Yep.
So this lady's basically saying that she understands something that she doesn't understand yet. And what she says she understands is that God's love is supposed to enter us. Uh-huh. As we progress.
Yep.
No, God's love isn't supposed to enter you as you progress. The reality is you can progress without any of God's love entering you.
Yeah.
So God's love isn't supposed to enter you as you progress.
Uh-huh.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And God's love, it will enter you when you have a pure, sincere longing for that love to enter you.
Yeah.
Of course, then you'll progress. But of course, the problem is developing a pure, sincere longing for God's love to enter you. The other thing is she's saying that it's supposed to. She doesn't believe it does.
Mm.
She just has been told that it's supposed to, or she thinks she's been told that it's supposed to, which I've never done, because I've never said that it's supposed to enter you as you progress, because I've only ever said that it enters you when you have a sincere, pure longing for it to enter you.
Yep.
So the whole concept that it's supposed to comes from this feeling that she have that she doesn't really believe in God's love in the first place.
Right.
So there's one major block to receiving God's love. Yeah. If your person doesn't have faith that God's love exists within them, mm-hmm. Within God to give to them,
yeah.
and doesn't have faith that they can long for God's love to enter them, then what happens is that they will probably not long for God's love. Mm. Whether they progress or not, they will not long for God's love. So the entering of God's love is dependent upon a sincere longing for that love to enter. Mm. And if you don't have that longing, God's love will not enter, no matter how much you emotionally progress. By the way, your emotional progress will be slower as well, because you'll have to change absolutely everything within your soul causally, one by one. Whereas God's love as it comes can help you start to address causal emotions by softening you to them.
Mm.
So God's love can help you immensely in feeling causal emotion. But if you don't have any faith that God's love can enter you, then of course God's love cannot enter you.
Yeah.
It's quite that simple. So that's one aspect of her question. Mm. So let's look at the next sentence.
Okay. Does it just take a really long time for some of us, and we just need to be patient?
So here's another problem.
Yeah.
This concept, and I think we've raised this concept a number of times in other FAQs, this concept that you just need to be patient and sooner or later something magical will happen,
yeah.
and you'll make some kind of transition and then everything will work smoothly and wonderfully, is actually untrue. The only way in which anything changes inside of the soul is by the soul's will being exercised for the change to occur. So there is not some magical process or some patience that you need to have about the soul changing. You need to find what's going on inside of your soul that's resisting the change,
mm-hmm.
and have a desire to do such a thing. You need to have a desire to allow such changes to occur. And unless the soul's will is exercised in that direction, you will not change.
Mm.
And it doesn't matter how patient you are, you won't change for a long time, if at all,
yeah.
right? So this is something we need to also mention. But we must say that you need to have patience with yourself, which is different than having patience about the process of change.
Okay.
When I say patience with yourself, there are sometimes you just don't get things. And there's sometimes when you need more diligent effort to get it. It's sort of like a person, if they go to a university course and they start studying, let's say, high-level mathematics, the average person would struggle,
yeah.
right? And they would need to have patience with themselves while still maintaining a desire to learn.
And using their will, presumably, to engage with learning.
Correct.
Yeah.
Now, that's different than having a patience of just sitting there and going, I'm not going to do anything, and I'm just going to wait for some magical thing that maybe God or someone else will bring to me so that I can finish up progressing. That's completely different. So one state is, I take full responsibility for my lack of progression.
Mm-hmm.
That is a person who takes responsibility for the use of their will. But I also need to be patient with myself in that state,
yeah.
which is very different than having patience waiting for some other thing to occur outside of myself before I change.
Uh-huh.
Of course, anything that occurs outside of yourself can help you change,
yeah.
but if you're resistive to change, it's not going to help you.
Yeah.
You have to develop the qualities of humility, the quality of desire for change. A sincere and pure longing has to be developed that comes from within your soul to change, just like a sincere, pure longing has to come from within your soul to connect to God's love. And that's not going to magically occur. It is something that you're going to have to develop with the exercise of your will.
Yeah. Okay. Will we keep going?
Yes.
Are there some signs that can show us that we are just not getting it?
Yes, plenty of signs. In fact, what this lady has said in this particular comment is a sign that she's not getting the underlying principles of how the soul works. You see, and instead of being condemnatory about that, what we need to go is, okay, I'm obviously not getting something. I'm obviously not understanding at some level what's really going on with my soul. I need to understand that. If no change is occurring and I am stagnant, that is the best sign.
Yeah.
It's a great sign that I don't get something, that it's me that doesn't get something. And what most people do there is they blame their teacher, or they blame God, or they blame, you know, anything other than themselves. But if we're really responsible, mm-hmm. we would say, well, actually, it's all dependent upon the use of my will. You see, from God's perspective, God wants you to make these changes. God loves you already. God wants to give you her love already. God is waiting for you to get into a condition where there's a sincere, pure desire inside of you to receive it. So from God's perspective, there's nothing to do with God as to why there's no change occurring. Yeah. God has everything in place. God's got laws in place to cause you to try to change. God is constantly trying to change you, to bring you to the place where God created you to be, the pure expression of your pure personality and nature. Mm-hmm. So God's already got everything in place. If no change is occurring, it's because we're resistive to everything God's got in place. And we must acknowledge that. Right? We must acknowledge that to ourselves, firstly, that there must be resistance within us. And then we need to develop a desire, through the use of our will, a desire to find what it is that's causing us to be resistive. Mm-hmm. To find the suppression that's in our soul, to find the resistance in our soul, and start to process our way through it. Only we can do that. No one else can do that for us. God can't do that for us, and no one else can do it for us either. Many might attempt to try if they are unloving, but they can't do it for us either.
Yeah.
The only person who can process their way through my emotions is me. No one else can do it for me. And this is something that's beautiful, because it shows you that God made us to be self-responsible individuals who come to see the power of exercising their own will. Mm. So I think it's a beautiful fact that this occurs. So any person who sort of says, oh, there'd be some kind of mysterious event that might occur, or someone will come along and save me from myself, and all of those kind of things, none of those things can happen. We can be saved from ourselves only by listening to other people who know how to progress, and then engaging through faith those methods of progression. The majority of people don't do that, of course. They don't engage it through faith or any other way. And unfortunately, they don't progress.
Yeah.
And yeah. There's a last statement she makes.
There is.
You wanted to raise another issue in what we just said?
No, when she asks, are there some signs that can show us that we're just not getting it? From what you said, if there's no change in our life without extreme force of will, then that's a sign that we're not getting it.
Yes, and honestly, there are many other signs. Yeah. Obviously, the law of attraction in our life will not be changing. We'll be attracting the same events time after time with different people. You know, our life is not going to be happy, so we'll be experiencing low amount of happiness in our lives. We'll often feel under attack. We'll often feel like, you know, things are not working well in our lives and we're not enjoying it. There's so many signs. You could list hundreds and hundreds of them in the end. Yeah. But it all results, it comes down or boils down to this one fact, that our life isn't changing for the better.
Yeah.
And if our life's not changing for the better, that's an indication that we're stagnant and we are not exercising our will to adjust that particular state of affairs.
Yeah. Mm. Okay, well, let's read the end.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm just not getting some really basic stuff.
Yes.
I'm really struggling with allowing myself to feel these emotions in the first place and scared that they will never end.
Yes.
Where do I start?
Well, what she has stated here is very interesting, because if she listens to her own statements, she will see that fear is the dominant emotion.
Mm-hmm.
So fear is suppressing her desire to change. It's suppressing her desire to feel emotions. She is afraid that if she starts feeling emotions, it will never end, which is not a truth, but it is a fear that a lot of people have. Yeah. And so what she needs to do is start looking at all the addictions she has to prevent herself from feeling these fears. The fact that these fears are in play is an indication that she must have addictions
yeah.
to look after each one of these fears.
Yeah.
So what she needs to do is to start looking at the addictions that she has. And she can do that by every time she gets angry, noticing why she got angry. Mm. And there's an addiction, something that wasn't met. Also, every time she feels good, she needs to look at that, because there's probably something that happened that fed one of her addictions.
Yep.
And if she allows herself to see every time she feels bad and every time she feels good, she will start acknowledging her addictions to herself. And once she starts acknowledging her addictions to herself, she has a chance to start to have a look at her fears that drive the addictions.
Yeah.
But already she has listed three in the question.
She has.
So that's where she could start. She could start with those three.
Yeah.
So what were they again, she said?
Well, the last two is that she's...
If you read the statement from the beginning...
I understand that God's love is supposed to be able to enter us as we progress.
Yes.
But I suspect I'm a long way off from this.
So one fear is that she doesn't have any feeling whatsoever that God's love can really enter her as she progresses.
Yeah. Yeah.
And she also has a feeling that it's supposed to without her effort.
Uh-huh.
So that's a problem.
Yes.
There's an addiction.
Yeah.
She wants to be able to progress without any personal effort.
Mm.
So that's an addiction. That's almost like saying, well, God's got to do all the work and then I'll progress. And that's not how it's going to work at all.
Yeah.
We need to do the work.
Yeah, mm. Yeah. And then she says, does it just take a really long time for some of us and we need to be patient? Are there some signs that can show us that we're just not getting it? I feel like I'm just not getting some really basic stuff. I'm struggling with
it. So there's one fear.
Yep, that I'm not getting it.
So fear that she's not getting some really basic stuff.
Yep.
Yeah.
Struggling to allow herself to feel these emotions in the first place.
So there's obviously fears that cause her to stop feeling emotions.
Mm-hmm. And scared that they will never end.
And that's one of her primary fears.
Yes.
And again, so already she's identifying through her question her fears without even knowing that she's identified what her fears are that are preventing her progress.
Yeah.
Well, so what's preventing her progress is evident from her question. And we find this quite a lot.
Definitely.
Where a person asks the question, but in the question contains their own answer to their own question.
Yeah.
So in her case with her emotions, inside of her question, she's showing that she has a thought that God should do it for her, mm-hmm. supposed to do it for her, and not much faith that that's the case.
Yeah.
She also is showing that she is quite afraid about processing through or feeling emotion.
Mm-hmm.
For one reason is that she feels that it's never going to end.
Yeah.
And she's also quite afraid about not understanding,
yeah.
about feeling like she's confused. And there's probably fears associated with that, associated feeling like a bit stupid and a bit dumb and not really, does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Which are all fears. Mm-hmm. So already there's quite a long list of fears that she can identify from her own question.
Yeah.
And if she allowed herself to identify them and then look at the addiction she has to cover over these fears, what she does every day to make sure that she doesn't feel those things,
yeah.
then she'll go a long way to realising why she does not progress.
Mm.
Yeah.
And you've actually given quite a lot of good advice about progression in this answer. So to recap, you've said that the lack of faith is an issue and that we need to work on faith.
A huge issue.
Yeah.
It's a huge. Most people on earth have very little faith in God.
Mm.
We don't trust that God's built our soul just right. We don't trust that God's built a perfect person and we've only got errors in us from our environment. We think somehow there's some intrinsic flaw that we were created with, when that's not the case. We don't trust that. We don't have faith in that.
Yeah.
There's so many things about God we don't have faith in. We don't think or have faith that God is a good being that loves. We only believe God's someone like our mummy or daddy, you know, who loves us sometimes, but only when we do what mummy or daddy says.
Yeah.
Or in the case of God, only when we do what God says.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
the only time we feel God's going to love us. Yeah. So there's a lot of false beliefs that we have in there,
yeah.
that we need to address and see. Otherwise, we won't develop a longing for God.
So faith's one area to look at.
A huge area.
The next thing you talked about was personal responsibility.
Yes.
And the...
So in other words, this whole concept that if I wait long enough, something will happen. No, if you wait long enough, you'll get old, decrepit and sick. And also, if you think about your day-to-day life, does anything ever happen when you just sit in one place? No, generally not.
You know, nothing really.
Even
good.
To turn on the telly, you've got to lift up your hand, go reach to the remote control, and at least switch a button. You've got to do something.
Yeah.
You know, it's just sitting and waiting for something to occur means that nothing is going to occur. Mm. Like.
Yeah, and so that's what you talked about, the difference between like a passive kind of patience where we're just waiting for something magical to happen to us that creates our progress versus a patience with self as we actively engage a process.
Correct.
Yeah.
So you can actively engage a process and not get it straight away. It's a bit like if you pick up a musical instrument right at the beginning and you try to play it, the very first things that come out of the musical instrument are generally not pleasant to listen to, right?
Yeah.
and if you don't have patience with yourself that you've just begun the process of learning, then you'll probably put down the musical instrument and never pick it up again. And it's very much the same with divine truth. We pick it up, we look at it, we're initially enthused by the intellectual concept of it,
mm-hmm.
but unfortunately what happens is we generally start to try to play with it, you know, start to experience it or experiment with it, and then we get very confused very rapidly because we haven't connected to our soul yet, and there's a lot of things we don't understand about our soul. And at that point, most people go, no, I think I'll put it down again.
Yeah.
Rather than being patient with themselves and saying, no, I'm a learner,
mm-hmm.
I'm going through a learning experience here. As long as I exercise my will to continue, I will get to the end of it eventually. And will is not the same as force.
Yeah, because that's the other way that we can approach progression, isn't it? To be very forceful with
ourselves
and self-punishing and hard upon ourselves.
Yes. I know one man who said to me, for the last 6 years, he said to me, I am going to get it. I am eventually going to get it. And I said to the man, I said, look, you know you're not getting it at the moment, right? And you're really quite angry about not getting it. All you need to do is feel how angry you are about not getting it. And he hasn't done that yet.
Yeah.
Right. So of course he can't get it while he doesn't go through that emotion.
Yeah.
So this is what the problem is for many people. They are, you know, they feel they force themselves to try to get it, but they're not getting it, and they have an emotion that they have to feel, but they don't feel it.
Yeah.
And that's the opening. Once they start to feel the emotion, and then they start getting things, then they realize, it was the emotion that caused me to not get it.
It's such a simple process, isn't it? We just need to keep feeling the next thing that comes up. And yet often we're so used to trying to control and be in charge and get to a goal and a destination.
Yeah. A child just feels the next thing that comes up. Yeah. They're not planning ahead for the future very much or looking at the past very much. They're just feeling the next emotion that comes up, whatever that emotion is. Now, a lot of children become damaged because of the childhood suppression. But if a child is left in a pure state in that regard, it can process through every emotion very, very rapidly within hours.
Yeah.
It's all done.
Yeah.
And this is where we as adults have the capacity to do that. But unfortunately, because of suppression and resistance and our belief systems and our intellect, we believe, you know, in hardly any principles about how the soul functions. You know, we don't have any understanding about how our own soul functions.
Yeah.
And as a result, we don't understand preclusion or absorption or progression or dominance or, you know, resistance or suppression or any of these concepts of the soul. We don't understand any of them. We don't understand presence and these kind of concepts. And so as a result, we're there trying to struggle with it all intellectually, not understanding any of the principles that govern our soul, believing, in fact, most of the time believing, that none of it's true.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the amount of times I've talked to people who say, I don't understand why I'm progressing, and I say to them, well, it's because you don't understand the soul. You don't believe that feeling an emotion is going to help you progress. And they go, yes, I do. And I say, no, you don't, because you don't let yourself feel any emotion. So how would you, how can you understand when you haven't let yourself feel one? You know?
Just to clarify there, you meant the person who said, I don't understand why I'm not progressing?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Said, well, I'm not progressing,
yeah,
sorry.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's all right.
Yeah.
Just...
Yeah, and so, you know, I feel a lot of people are in this state where they don't understand what's going on because they have no understanding of how the soul works.
Yeah.
And as a result, they're still holding on quite strongly to the concept that they can intellectually force change, which is not a soul quality.
Yeah, yeah. Mm. And so that's some of the other things that you said in answer to this question was that... obviously we know we're stagnant or we're not getting it when there's no change happening in our lives.
Correct.
But then there's this issue of having a will and a desire for change. And if we're not changing, we obviously don't have the desire. Mm-hmm. And that's because of fear. And we need to start feeling anger and fear and addiction.
Yes. Yeah. So fear is a primary reason why we don't change. And fear is covered over, like smoothed over by addiction. Mm. And when we get angry, it's a demonstration of when our addictions are not getting met.
Yeah.
So instead of our addiction not getting met, so we feel some fear, what we do is revert to rage. Mm. And when we get our addictions met, we go, oh, isn't the world lovely and beautiful? And isn't everybody lovely and beautiful? And oh, I have so many nice friends and everything's wonderful. And we tell ourselves a whole heap of crap about our life.
Yeah.
Because we want our addictions met, because our addictions help us to overcome our fears.
Yeah.
And it's only when we're brave enough to look at the rage that we have and look at our addictions and then start to examine our fears that true progression will occur. And in fact, the biggest work that most people on this planet will need to do is working through their fears.
Mm-hmm.
If you're not prepared to work through your fear, you have no way of progressing. Simple as that. There's no way you can progress without working through fear.
Mm.
And most people don't want to, because they feel it's too painful.
Mm.
And they're not prepared to feel pain. But the irony is, every time you suppress a fear, physical pain results.
Yeah.
So now you're creating more pain.
Yeah.
And this is a sad state of humanity, because we don't understand how the soul functions. We even believe that disease is not of our own creation. Mm. And it is.
Mm. Yeah. Mm. More questions we're going to ask you about fear specifically. Sure. as we go through this series. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, so. I think we've now up to 150 or 200 questions in this series already. And the reality is, I think we'll be going quite some time answering people's emotional questions, which isn't a bad thing, because in the end, you know, we need to learn to become emotional beings who don't judge emotion and who allow emotions to occur and who allows emotions to flow. We need to learn how to do these things. But
yeah.
And there is, unfortunately, a large amount of disinformation on this planet about emotion. And that we're going to have to wade our way through and sort out and eventually come to resolution of. And that's one of the main reasons why the majority of people on the planet never progress while they're on Earth.
Yeah. Okay, well, let's keep going. Thank you for that one. This question is another sort of long paragraph from someone.
Sure.
So I'll read it out and we can go back through it.
Okay. Yeah.
I've used shaming methods to try to change the behaviour of my son and other people.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm beginning to realise how much my own suppressed or denied shame has impacted and still impacts on my actions and beliefs.
Mm-hmm.
For a long time, I've tried to change my behaviour and actually believed that I'd succeeded. No shortage of arrogance and self-deception here. I'm beginning to emotionally realise that it's not possible to change through trying to change my actions. Why do we find it so personally difficult to accept the truth and come to terms with our shame?
I find this person's last question, like the last state, the last sentence.
Sentence, yeah.
Quite incongruous with the rest of the question.
Yeah.
Because I find it's quite strange that she's asking that particular part of the question,
mm-hmm.
when the reality is the real question needs to be asked about why she doesn't understand, why she believes taking actions is going to ever cause any change. And that is the real question, not the question that she's actually asked. But let's look at the question she asked. So let's list that question, just the last statement.
Why do we find it so personally difficult to accept the truth and come to terms with our shame?
Yes. So she's asking about shame. And like, yes, I would like to answer a whole series of questions about shame later, I feel. Because there are a lot of problems on the planet because we're unwilling to feel shame. But that is not the reason why we damage others with our shame.
So perhaps
and
we
this,
could...
And this is what we need to understand.
Yeah.
Just because we have an emotion in us of a certain type, it does not mean that that is the reason why we damage other people with the resistance or suppression of that emotion. We damage other people because we have chosen to damage them, and we prefer it to feeling our own pain. So this question is not really about shame, it's about pain generally. The lady is unwilling to feel her own pain. Mm. As a result, she is willing to take actions that cause pain in others.
So this is where, in the beginning, she's referring to shaming her son and other people.
Correct.
That's because she's unwilling to feel something inside of herself.
Correct. She's unwilling to feel her own pain, and so she creates pain in others. And like she said, she thought that she'd worked on the issue and overcome it, but it's pretty obvious to her now that she has not. And this is great.
Yeah.
This is great that now she realises she has not solved this particular problem. And she realises too, in the statement she made, she realises that changing your actions doesn't change anything, because in the end even your actions don't change.
Yes.
So she has continued to shame others and shame her son in order to manipulate and control their behaviour. And she uses in an internal justification for doing so. And what she needs to do is find what the internal justification is. And it's not shame. It's not shame that causes her to justify treating others in a shameful manner.
Mm-hmm.
It's her desire to avoid her own pain and her desire to attack other people that causes her, and manipulate, by the way, and control other people, that causes her to use shame as a tool of control. So this is where we have to be very careful. See, what I see a lot of people doing is they say, look, the truth is the other day I yelled at my son or daughter. And then they say, that's because I was yelled at when I was a child. Or that's because I was treated badly when I was a child. Or that's because I felt bad, you know, I felt the emotion of, you know, a lack of worth when they spoke to me, or whatever it is. No, it wasn't. It wasn't for any of those reasons. It was because you decided to attack another person rather than feeling your own pain. Mm. That's the only reason why you did it. You didn't do it for any other reason. You did it because you made a decision. You didn't want to feel your pain in that situation, and you wanted them to feel pain instead.
Yeah.
You wanted to attack them. That's why you attacked them. You wanted to shame them. You wanted to control them. You wanted to manipulate them. That's why you did it. You didn't do it because you have shame. Yeah. You did it because you have justification of abusive behavior, which is a completely different emotion than shame.
Yeah.
And in fact, if you were truly shamed, you would never be able to justify it. If you truly felt some shame, you would never be able to justify attacking another person just so that you can avoid your own pain.
Yeah, so you're saying that if we were truly in contact with our shame,
yes,
and feeling it, not suppressing it, or at least sensitive to it from a feeling perspective.
Correct.
So when it's triggered, we sense it.
Yeah.
Then we would never be able to shame another person in avoidance of that shame.
No, I'm not saying that.
Right.
I am saying that you could still,
yeah,
because you may have an internal justification of abusing another person,
yeah,
which is a completely different emotion.
So can you clarify what you meant about if you were really feeling your shame?
If I really feel my shame, I can still potentially abuse another person. Because it's not my shame that causes me to abuse another person. It's my willingness to cause pain in another person that causes me to abuse the other person.
Yeah.
And in avoidance of my own pain, not my own shame. Does that make sense?
It does.
And this is where I feel a lot of people, they blame an emotion. They say, oh, it's because of shame that I did that to my son. No, it's not. It's not. It's not because of shame that you do that to your son. It's because you're avoiding your own pain that you do that to your son, and you want him to feel as much pain as you have. And you want to control him, and you want to manipulate him, and you want to tell him what to do, and you don't want to smack him because you have different, you know, you have other judgments about that. But you're totally willing to abuse him emotionally. Which is abuse. Mm. You're willing to abuse another person because you want to avoid your own pain. And that's not about shame. That is about your willingness to abuse another person. Your willingness to take an unloving action to the extent that you're willing to harm someone else. Mm-hmm. And that is totally independent of how much shame you have. You could have a mountain of shame in you and never do that. Or you could have a smidge of shame in you and still do that.
Yeah.
It is completely independent of each other, these two emotions. The emotion of desiring to abuse another is completely independent of the emotion inside of yourself.
Yeah.
It's your justification. Right? And this is where we've got to be very careful. What I'm saying is this lady is justifying shame as the reason why she takes abusive behavior towards her son and others.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not her shame that causes the abusive behavior. It is her willingness to avoid her own pain and make herself feel better by abusing another that causes her to abuse another. And because shame is a technique that was used on her, she now knows the technique and she uses that as a technique
mm-hmm.
to harm another.
Mm-hmm.
But the reason why she's doing it is not because of her own shame, it's because of her own willingness to abuse another.
Yeah.
And this is where I see a lot of people getting way off board with their emotions. They believe that the emotion is one thing, when actually the emotion is quite a dark, much darker emotion in another direction that causes them to take a certain action.
Yeah.
And I feel that while we want to discuss shame, we also need to be careful of using shame as an excuse for very terrible decisions and behaviours that we make in avoidance of our own pain.
Mm.
And most people do this. Most people wish to avoid their own pain by attacking another, manipulating another, controlling another, so that they don't trigger them, as the saying goes, so they don't feel something from what the other person is doing. And that's all about personal avoidance of your own pain. That's all about your own selfishness and narcissism. It's not about your shame.
Yeah.
And this is what we need to come to terms with. We need to come to terms with that just because we have an emotion in us from our childhood, that emotion is not the cause of us abusing other people and harming other people. That emotion is an excuse we often are using to abuse other people, but it is not the cause. The cause is an internal belief that we have the right to harm another people just because, or as a method of avoiding our own pain. That's the cause.
Mm.
And that's a completely different emotional cause
mm-hmm.
than the internal shame the woman is experiencing.
Mm. So, from what you're saying, that the reason we do harm to others is because we have an emotional justification of doing that harm.
Mm-hmm.
And often we justify it in order to avoid our own pain.
Mm-hmm.
But regardless of what that pain is, the emotion in play is a sense of justification or entitlement, or that it's okay to do this harmful thing under this circumstance.
Correct.
And presumably all of us, or people, have different circumstances under which they would justify harm.
Correct.
It might differ between people.
Yes.
But whenever we do harm, we have that emotion, and that's what needs to be dealt with.
Yes. Yep. So if you gave the average mother a knife and said, murder your child, the average mother wouldn't do it. But if you get the average mother pregnant and she doesn't want the child, she is willing to do it.
Yeah.
So in other words, she has an internal justification under some circumstance that murder of a child is acceptable.
Mm.
Right? Now that is independent of the emotions that she feels when she feels that.
Yeah.
So in other words, when she feels like the reasons why, she will use a whole heap of tools of justification. And that is, I can't cope with having the child. Well, have the child and give it away.
Mm.
You know, there's plenty of people who don't have children who want to have a child.
Mm-hmm.
Give it to them. If you don't want to have it yourself.
Yeah.
You know? Oh, but I couldn't do that because then I wouldn't be viewed as a bad mother. Well, feel that.
Yeah.
Feel that you're not a good mother.
Yeah.
If you need to feel that. Oh, I couldn't do it because, you know, the man I got pregnant to, I don't like him very much, and this child will tie me to him the rest of their life. Okay, well, take some responsibility of that and feel that.
Yes.
Feel that emotion of what it's going to be like tied to that man for the rest of your life, a reminder of one of your immoral acts
yeah.
for the rest of your life.
Yeah.
Feel what that feels like. But she doesn't want to feel any of those things. And instead, she's willing to justify the murder.
Mm.
And it's the justification of the unloving act which is going to darken her soul more than the actual emotions in her that were there prior to the event.
Yeah.
So, you know, this is the problem that we face, is that quite often we say or want it to be reasonable to do certain things. And it's never, so in this case, it's never reasonable to abuse your own children emotionally, physically, sexually, or in any way. It's never reasonable. And yet most people do it in some way. Why do they do it? Because they don't want to feel their own pain.
Yeah.
And they feel they'd like to take their pain out on someone else.
Mm-hmm.
And that's very different than actually identifying the emotion of shame as the cause.
Yes.
So this is where I feel it's very important for a person to understand that.
Yeah, I feel that's very important. And it is the case, not just with our children, but anyone that we choose to harm.
Correct.
We obviously have a feeling that that is justified in that case.
Yes.
And that is what we need to deal with first, isn't it?
Yes. We need to look at the internal justification for the unloving act.
Mm.
And we have amazing justifications for unloving acts. And a lot of our justifications we believe are reasonable.
Yeah.
We believe that if we didn't believe it, we'd never do it.
Mm-hmm.
So we do believe they're reasonable. So the woman who aborts the child believes the justification for the abortion is reasonable.
Well, even if you use that example of giving a mother a knife and saying to her,
kill your child.
And if you use a different example of giving a mother a knife and saying someone else wants to kill your child, she might not ever feel justified in murdering her child, but she might feel justified in murdering
the other person.
The other person.
Exactly. Who is somebody's child.
Who's somebody's child, exactly.
Yeah.
And society would also
possibly justify it.
Yeah. A lot of people would justify that.
In many countries of the world, there's still the death penalty. So, of course, in every one of those countries, the majority of people justify it.
Yeah.
So they justify, from God's perspective, an unlawful act in order to prevent them from feeling certain emotions.
Yeah.
That's all they're doing.
Yeah.
And this is something that we need to understand. We're just justifying things all the time. We're justifying unloving acts all the time. And we need to stop doing it if we're ever going to change. We need to look at the reasons why we justify it. What fears drive these justifications? And shame is a causal emotion. It's not fear.
Yeah.
Completely different.
Yeah.
So the lady attacking her son emotionally by shaming him and which controls him and manipulates him, that is an unloving act driven not by her shame but by her fear.
Yeah. And it may be the fear of her shame or her
fear
of other pain, mightn't it?
Fear of other pain.
And she's using shame as
a convenient scapegoat.
Yeah.
To avoid the real feelings.
Yep. But regardless of what the real thing is we're avoiding, the thing to deal with is the fear of that thing.
Correct.
Yeah.
And the only way you can deal with the fear of that thing is to deal with your rage of that thing and the addictions of that thing.
Yep.
And then you'll get to your fear of that thing.
Well, partly your addiction is feeling that it's okay to harm another when an emotion is triggered. Is that right?
Well, I'd say that's the rage perspective.
The rage.
Yeah. Yep. So it's okay to harm someone when your addiction is not met. So let's say a person has an addiction for safety.
Yeah.
When that addiction is not met, in other words, they feel unsafe, now they feel justified to murder somebody.
Yep.
So, you know, in the case of a child, of a mother with an abortion, she's okay normally. She doesn't go around murdering people. But when her fear is triggered and her addiction is no longer going to be met, now she feels justified in murdering a child that's yet unborn.
Yeah.
Who has no control over the situation whatsoever.
Mm.
And yet, if that child was born, she would be convicted as a murderess and probably looked down upon by society for many, many years.
Mm.
Right? And yet when it's unborn, she has the justification that it's unborn, it's not a real child yet, I can get away with it, right? And this is all how far we'll go in our justification.
Yeah.
We will murder in our justification.
Yeah.
The average person will murder in their justification.
Yeah.
And unless you're willing to release the causal emotional reason why that's the case, you will justify really bad behaviour that causes the degradation of your own and other people's soul.
Mm. And some of that justification can be created just through the belief that I shouldn't have to feel fear.
I shouldn't have to feel fear. I shouldn't have to have some kind of inconvenience. I shouldn't have to have some kind of discomfort. I shouldn't have to, like, and that's arrogance.
Yes.
That's also a lack of personal responsibility. So they are not shame-based emotions. They're different emotions that are causing that action. Mm. So this is why, you know, I find this question quite interesting. And here I'm not judging the woman. I'm just stating that this is an illustration. It's a great illustration, in fact, of how people want it to be one emotion that's causing their problem, and even justifying that one emotion as the cause of their problem, while at the same time not realizing, no, there are much darker emotions driving this action that you're engaging in regularly than just this emotion of, you know, shame or whatever it is that they feel that is the main cause of problem. And this is where I don't agree with the average concepts of most psychologists and psychiatrists and everything, that shame is the major cause of unloving behaviour. I don't agree with that. I do feel that it is certainly a participant in causes of unloving behaviour.
And surely it's the avoidance of shame rather than the feeling of shame.
Correct. Yeah. It is the avoidance of any painful emotion that causes unloving behaviour. And we need to stop avoiding painful emotion. Then we will not, you know, once we stop avoiding painful emotion, we will then not engage unloving behaviour so readily.
Yeah.
You know, we'll feel the unloving emotion instead. That's what we will do. We will feel the underlying emotion. And this is where we need to go as a society. We need to stop justifying behaviour through belief systems that is unloving, and we need to start saying no behaviour that is unloving is justifiable under any circumstances. And then we need to start looking at ourselves and saying, okay, internally I have feelings that they are justifiable. I need to get those feelings that are inside of me and work through my anger and my addictions and my fears associated with those feelings so that I no longer justify these unloving behaviours. And that is completely separate to our processing of shame.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So I feel we will answer questions about shame later on, but I just wanted to address this feeling of using an emotion to justify unloving behaviour, and basically using an emotion as an excuse to justify unloving behaviour. And this is self-delusion. So it's interesting, in the statement or the question this lady asks, she's acknowledging that she has been in self-delusion and arrogance, but just not acknowledging how bad it goes, how deeply it is rooted inside of her. It's so deeply rooted that she's willing to use an emotion of harm to damage her own child in order to control and manipulate his behaviour.
Yeah.
That's how strongly entrenched her belief is that she should be able to avoid her own pain and her willingness to attack another person and make them feel as much pain as she feels.
Yeah.
And that is a very unloving course of action. And rather than her feeling all like guilty and punished about it now that I've said all these things, it would be far better for her to look at the reason why she feels she can justify this.
Yeah, and look, I think this is such valuable information for all of us because all of us at the moment are taking unloving actions, and that's
justifying it.
Well, we have to be justifying it in order to do it.
Exactly.
And that's such an important dynamic to recognise, and to not get caught up in this idea of throwaway comments like, "Oh, I did that because of my shame," or because of, you know, that happened to me as a kid, so I did it again.
Yeah.
You know,
and it didn't happen. Like under those circumstances, every single sexual abuser every person who's been sexually abused would be a sexual abuser, and that's not the case.
No.
See, some of them are so angry that they feel justified to abuse another.
Yeah.
Some of them are not.
Yeah.
Some of them feel so hurt that they could never abuse another the same way.
Yes.
And see, it's a very, very different response.
Yes.
And the response is completely independent of what happened.
Yeah.
The response is based upon a justification that they should be able to take an action to damage another because that action was taken to damage them.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a very, very different emotion that drives that.
Yeah.
That's emotions of, you know, arrogance, lack of humility to your emotion, a desire to avoid your own pain, a desire to create as much pain in other people that you have inside of yourself, and so forth. And they are quite dark emotions. And we need to acknowledge they exist inside of us and then look at the root causes of them, which are all emotions that we need to experience and release.
Great.
G'day.
Thank you. I think that'll be helpful for a lot of people, actually, that question and answer.
Yeah, I feel so. Like, I feel that a lot of people are using sort of emotional excuses for their behaviour. And there is no excuse for bad behaviour.
No.
From God's perspective, there is no excuse for bad behaviour at all. That's why every one of God's loving laws corrects bad behaviour for whatever reason you took it.
Yes.
And this is why every one of God's laws, there is a penalty upon your soul if you take an action that results in your being unloving to another person. There will be a penalty on your soul. And this is independent of how many things have happened to you.
Yeah.
Right? And so it should be.
Yeah.
Because you're making a decision to harm another purposefully, and you shouldn't be. If anything, what you should be doing is feeling the own harm that was brought to you and never, never harm another because of how much you were harmed.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and a person who's truly loving would never wish to harm another person just because they themselves have been harmed in the past.
Mm. And they would never even consider it as a justification,
never.
Would they? Because when we are developed in love, we take responsibility for all of our actions.
Yes.
Because that's how God views
yes.
us as well.
And we see our actions as independent as to what happened to us.
Mm-hmm.
And what I mean by that is that we see our taking an action to harm another as a decision we are now making to harm another. And it doesn't matter what excuse we use for that decision. The reality is we are taking a decision, making one, to harm another. And that's what somebody did to harm us.
Mm.
And really, if we think about it logically, we can see that somebody who did it to us obviously thought they had a justification at the time.
Yeah.
Right? And does it feel inside of you like there was any justification? No, it does not. And this is how it feels from God's perspective. From God's perspective, there is no justification for any unloving behaviour.
Yeah.
None whatsoever. And if you are making justifications for unloving behaviour, you are already extremely out of harmony with God's laws of love, and therefore you will receive the penalty of being so much out of harmony.
Mm.
Yeah. It's very, very damaging to believe that you have the right to harm another just because you have been harmed.
Yeah.
Even by that person.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Yeah. Mm. Great. Thank you. Our next question comes from, I don't know who it comes from, but it involves a paragraph, so I'll read that to you.
Okay.
They say, how can I deal with suppressed anger of many, many years? I do not seem to accept emotionally this anger, even when I know it is the only way for me to go forward.
Mm-hmm.
How can I accept this anger, which will lift the roof of my castle, in inverted commas? And will it help me to release myself and to be free?
Mm-hmm.
How can someone deal with anger when you when you always have shown another persona?
Mm-hmm. A facade.
Is it because I have to forgive and I'm not ready, !! to do so? I know I have to do the work myself and that no one else can do this for me, but how can I go past this huge block?
Mm. Well, the question itself again demonstrates a lot of the errors of thinking here
mm-hmm.
that are causing this person to remain blocked towards processing anger. If we look at some of the statements that are made, first if we go to this statement, when am I ready? You know, like when will I be ready, or am I ready, or will I become ready?
I'm not ready.
I'm not ready.
Yeah.
All of these things. These statements saying you're not ready, they are just an excuse to get you away from the responsibility of taking control of your own life.
Mm.
Whenever you say you're not ready, you're basically saying, I don't want to take control of my own life. Because when you decide, really decide with a pure heart, that you want to take control of your own life, you will do it, right? And it's not some magical solution that you'll become ready through a whole series of processes, although the law of attraction is going to bring you a whole series of processes which will eventually force you into being ready. But even then, you will still need to make the choice and decision to, through the use of your will, to take the action to process through something emotionally. Mm-hmm. Now, in the case of this person, it's again a lady, I can feel, who basically is struggling with anger and rage.
Yeah.
And she's saying that she's suppressed her anger and rage for many, many years.
Yeah.
Well, yes, this is a problem. Suppression of anger and rage for many, many years is a problem. However, she likes to have the anger and rage within her. Mm-hmm. Because if she didn't like it, she would release it.
Yeah.
So she likes it. So what I would do first is examine the reasons why having anger and rage within her is acceptable to her.
Yeah.
What she gets out of having anger and rage within her.
Yeah.
And she will find that people are automatically scared of her, and she likes that.
Mm.
Because it gives her control over situations she otherwise would not have control over.
Yeah.
Right? So what she needs to do is examine with a pure heart the real reasons why she likes to be angry, or why she likes to have anger within her at least. And there'll be a lot of emotional reasons why a person wants to feel and never release their anger. A lot of it's to do too with feeling of weakness. They feel angry, anger makes them feel strong,
yeah,
and powerful. And they are unwilling to feel weak and powerless. And so they become addicted to having the anger remain within them.
Yeah.
But there's also, this lady has some guilt about the anger remaining in her.
She does.
She does. So this is an indication that in her childhood probably there's been some experiences where the anger was condemned or judged in some way, or even she was punished. So she's afraid of expressing it.
Yep.
Now, she is going to have to at some point go through acknowledgement of many of these emotions in order to start feeling her anger. Mm. And even when she starts feeling her anger, she's going to have to be very careful. Because if she's not careful, she will use her anger as a tool to feel powerful rather than as a, you know, just feeling her anger alone in her bedroom and releasing it so that she can get to the addiction that is underneath it. It's always an addiction that's underneath the anger.
It's very interesting, isn't it, how you've spoken in many seminars saying to people, you need to release your anger. Like, you often use the phrase, get out the baseball bat and go and beat the punching bag or whatever it is. But
this woman hasn't even tried that, I'd feel.
No.
And the reason why is she's justifying the keeping of the anger inside of her. She doesn't really want to even attempt to release it. And that is an issue and a problem. Yeah.
So it seems like from what you're saying, just that act of getting the baseball bat and punch or bashing something is not necessarily the way we're going to actually release anger.
Not in this case.
Because we have to work through these investments we have in maintaining it that you mentioned, things like control and feeling of strength. And
well, she's suppressing her anger for a start, so she needs to look at the belief systems that she has about why she needs to suppress her anger.
So that could be about facade and things like
and
that.
And that is a lot about facade, yes, about wanting to maintain a facade, wanting to look better than she actually feels inside, and holding on to feeling that if people see her real anger and real self and how angry she actually is, that no one will love her and no one will care for her. And there's a lot of other reasons why she would be suppressing her anger. And she needs to be sincere about finding them.
Mm-hmm.
And she's not,
mm-hmm,
at this point, sincere about finding them. She needs to allow herself to develop a sincerity to find the reasons why she suppresses her anger.
Yeah.
The second thing she needs to do is to find the reasons why she resists her anger, right? And that suppression and resistance are not always the same thing. They're not always the same reasons. for some people, they resist their anger for a different reason than they suppress it. So sometimes we suppress it because of how other people might feel, and we resist it because we might feel something.
Yeah.
Does that mean we might feel bad, or we're afraid that we'll actually do something really bad when we're angry, or something like that? And they are different fears that are causing us to resist. So she needs to look at the soul, how the soul functions in this aspect of suppression and resistance, because these are the things stopping her from feeling her anger. And she needs to look at the belief systems that surround the reasons why she believes she should suppress and resist her anger.
Yeah.
And she needs to be sincere about this process of doing that. Then she'll at least start expressing some anger, and then she's going to have to be very careful, because inside of her there are some emotions where she wants to hold on to the anger because it feels powerful and in control. And there's a temptation going to be for her that when she starts expressing her anger, that she uses it to gain power and control, rather than actually going into a bedroom and privately, or being privately expressive of her own rage and just connecting to the rage itself.
Yeah.
So that's the course of action I would suggest that she takes. Now, she's going to find that quite difficult to take, and there are lots of reasons why. Because a person who's been suppressing anger for years and years obviously has some very strong investments in the suppression. And unless she's really sincere about those investments, it's going to be very, very difficult for her to allow herself to experience her anger. But she must understand that this is something to do with her will. She's going to need to have a strong will to get to that place. And it doesn't matter, you know, there's not going to be any other magical solution. There's not going to be someone or some event that comes along that that causes her to all of a sudden do it magically. She's going to have to allow the law of attraction to bring her events still, but she's going to have to soften to the feeling of anger that she has in acknowledgement, and allow the expression of it in a private way, so that she doesn't connect to these other addictions of maintaining power and control. So it is going to be quite a difficult process for her to begin doing that. Now, of course, she can pray to her God to allow her to help her, to bring events to her that trigger her anger so that she can have a more sincere look at her anger. She can also ask for help from her guides to remind her to not go into the power place and not go into the wanting control over others when she experiences her anger, but rather remove herself to a place of personal safety and safety for others when she experiences her anger.
Yeah.
But she also needs to understand that her anger is driven by addiction and fear.
Yeah.
And at some point she's going to have to get beyond her desire to stay angry and get into more of a desire to feel the addiction that drives it, and then get into the fear that controls the addiction that drives her anger. And that's going to mean softening to quite a few emotions that she's unprepared to soften to at this point in time. I know she's unprepared because she's suppressing anger. if she wasn't suppressing her anger, she would be then feeling her anger, which means that she's prepared to feel her anger.
Yeah.
That she wants to feel her anger in her soul. At this stage, she does not want to feel her anger in her soul, and so I would look at why she does not want to feel the anger in her soul. What are her internal justifications for retaining this anger within her?
So why she thinks it's a good idea to stay the way she is rather than to change.
Correct.
Yeah.
And she'll have very strong emotional investments, some of which involve other people and some of which involve herself, about the reason why she wants to remain in this place of anger. The key is to allow yourself to feel every one of them. When you feel them, they'll release from you. And then once they release from you, you'll start feeling anger more readily. And then you'll have to be careful about how you experience your anger. And you'll have to start allowing yourself to see it's the addiction now that drives that anger.
Yeah.
And allow yourself to start feeling the addiction and your justification for the rage-based response to the addiction not being met.
Seems to me that there's two ways that we can experience anger, and one is in a way that's quite harmful to others.
Yes.
And another is a way where it feels quite painful to ourselves, but
doesn't harm others.
But doesn't harm others.
Yes.
And that second space is the space where change happens, we get more in contact with our addictions, fear is more evident, those things.
Yes. There's a lovely scripture in the Bible and it says, be angry, but do not sin.
Yeah.
When we sin, it means that when we, that's when we take the action to harm another or harm ourselves in our anger. Many people do that too. Many people get so angry with themselves that they're willing to suicide or take, you know, cut themselves and do other things towards themselves. Both actions are sinning.
Yeah.
You need to stop taking actions that are out of harmony with love towards yourself or another, but just feel the anger. And this is where most people, again, aren't prepared to go. They're not prepared to feel the pain that's involved with feeling anger.
Mm.
They want to act out their anger and start blaming the environment, someone externally, for their anger, or even harming themselves for, you know, for having the anger, rather than actually just feeling the anger as an emotional experience. The most loving thing to do with anger is to feel it as an emotional experience and find the underlying addiction that covers the fear.
Yeah.
Because it's the addiction that covers the fear that is causing the justification for the rage.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we need to find it.
Yeah.
And we need to be sincere about finding it.
And it seems that we also need to be sincere about breaking down the facade we have around our anger.
Correct.
This lady's saying, you know, she's used to being, showing another persona to others.
Yes.
And lots of people,
and there's a lot of fear in that.
Yes.
So there is, in her, there is fear of anger.
Mm.
And her fear of anger is a lot about things like, you know, what's going to happen to her if she experiences it. How will other people perceive her? Mm. Will she be punished? Will she be violently abused if she feels a feeling of anger? And these, all of these kind of feelings come from our childhood generally, where we have been violently abused when we felt angry, or where we were afraid of the withdrawal of love when we got angry and so forth. And these are all feelings that need to be experienced before a soul change can take place. And it doesn't matter how much you maintain a facade and try to act lovingly, the real soul change will not occur until you feel your way through those emotions and develop a desire. And obviously to do that, you need to develop a desire to feel your way through those emotions rather than reverting to the facade.
Yeah.
So what we notice a lot of people are attempting to do is they want to revert to the facade. It's like, you know, you go, here we go again, another facade, you know. And then they say, then they, like, we had a recent exchange of emails with somebody who we told her about her facade. She emails back another facade.
Yeah.
And we tell her about that facade. She emails back another facade.
Yeah.
And it's, when are you going to give up the facade and just say that you're really angry? and stop making out that you actually got a handle of it and realize that you've got no idea what's going on.
It's, you know, so crazy, isn't it? Because we naturally respond to a person with less facade, and yet most of us are so invested in maintaining our facade, aren't
Correct,
we?
Yeah. And we have all sorts of emotional reasons why we want to maintain the emotional facade. So we need to stop focusing on, you know, stop focusing on the facade itself and start focusing on why we wish to maintain it.
Yeah.
And that requires some sincere analysis of yourself emotionally. You need to feel about why, what you get out of the facade.
Mm.
You get other people thinking you're something you're not. Isn't that wonderful? It's what you think. But I tell you what, a lot of people who have invested in facade on the earth after they pass into the spirit world are absolutely shocked because they realize there is no way they can maintain the facade anymore. And the only way they can anyway maintain a facade is by coming back to earth, being invisible to other people.
Mm.
Because everybody they see in the spirit world sees exactly who they are. No facade, right? And that's why a lot of people become earthbound, because they hate the idea that everybody can see them.
Can see
them. And they'd rather stay here on earth where nobody can really see them.
Yeah.
You know? Because they don't ever want to work their way through their desire for their own facade.
Mm.
And this is, again, you know, we keep emphasizing this in these emotional questions. The use of your will is paramount in solving every problem.
Yeah.
You need to use your will. You need to have a desire to address these problems before they're ever going to be solved.
Mm.
And that's where I see the majority of people struggling with the exercise of their will. They want a magical solution.
Yeah.
They want someone to come along and save them. They want somebody to cure them without them having to take any action. They want a pill for their problem,
yeah,
rather than actually coming to terms with what's caused the problem inside of them and feel the pain associated with that.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thanks.